On behalf of the First Baptist Church family here in Pulaski, Tennessee, thank you so much for joining us for this worship service. We think you'll pretty quickly see that we are not a bunch of spit and polish professionals. We're not the most gifted people around. As a matter of fact, we make all kinds of mistakes. We're a long way from perfect. And maybe you can relate to us in that way. And that's okay. Because our belief is that God's Son, Jesus Christ, is the only perfect person who ever lived. And Jesus took his perfection and did something amazing with it. He offered himself as payment for our sins, rose from the dead, ascended into heaven, sent the Holy Spirit, and is right now preparing a place for us to be with him. The service you're about to watch, hiccups and all, is not about us performing for God, each other, or you. This service is about a bunch of imperfect people worshiping a perfect God. We have prayed that God meets you right where you are as you enter into this service with us. And if you're ever able, we would be thrilled for you to join us, live and in person. May the living God be glorified in this service, in our lives, and in yours, now and forever. And again, thank you so much for joining us.
Good morning and happy almost 4th.
Good morning.
Good morning. You want to tell them happy almost 4th? Good morning and happy almost 4th. All right. Well, do you guys have big plans tonight or tomorrow? You do? Good. Be careful with those fireworks Mr. Rodney was talking about. And probably don't play any around him because he likes them too much, it sounds like. Yes. All right. Well, this morning, I wanted to ask you guys, how many of you like bubbles? And don't bubbles just make you happy? I remember in college, my mom used to get me bubbles because I'd be stressed out all the time, and she's like, here, blow these bubbles. And so I used to sit in my room and just blow them and watch them. But I love bubbles, and I wanted to see if I could share some with you this morning. Ooh, that was a big one. Do you guys want some bubbles? Nice. Nice. Sorry, guys, they won't reach that far. I only have so much breath. What's the first thing you want to do whenever you see bubbles? Pop them, yes. Well, the first thing you want to do when you see a bubble is pop them. I mean, it's kind of just what you do when you pop. I think that's actually if it had directions, it would probably say blow bubbles, then pop them. Like, I feel like that's just what you do when you have bubbles. This time when I blow them, though, I want you to not pop them. Okay, then you can do that. All right. Oh, Aubrey had it. She almost moved her arms. Oh. Oh. Need a little more. Oh, they're dodging them. Is that hard to do? Did you want to pop them? It's a little hard to do? Well, today we're talking about the last fruit of the Spirit. Now, I did that this morning because the last fruit of the Spirit, you needed this to be able to not pop those bubbles. What do you think it is? Self-control. Yes. Yes, we talk about the fruit of the Spirit, and today, our last one we're going to talk about is self-control. What does it mean to have self-control? Say it louder. Controlling yourself. Yes, pretty much. I mean, it's kind of in the name, but when we have self-control, we have to control our feelings. We have to control our actions. We have to control our thoughts. We have to control our emotions. It takes discipline. It means that we can't give in to something just because we want to do it in that moment, because it may not be good for us. It means not spending money on candy or toys or music when we know we don't have the money to do that. It means not complaining when our mom asks us to go clean our room. It means not striking back when somebody hurts us in some way. Self-control, does it sound easy? No, sometimes it can be pretty hard. It requires us to think before we speak. It requires us to think before we act. And it means just keeping our emotions in check. And sometimes it even means going the extra mile for somebody. Now, while that may be difficult, Luckily, we have someone who's the ultimate example of how we should live our lives and how we should have self-control, and that's through Jesus. And today in Children's Church, we're going to be talking about how he is our ultimate example for that and how he can help us to have more self-control. Now, since it's our last Sunday talking about the fruits of the Spirit, would anybody like to share with everybody what the Galatians 5:22-23 verse is? Anybody? Kylie Wiley, you want to? All right, come here.
But the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faith, gentleness, and self-control.
Very good, Kylie Wiley. Yes, so today we're going to be talking more about self-control, but right now let's bow our heads and pray together. Dear God, we love you and thank you just for the example that you give us through Christ to live our lives. And we thank you for the way that you love us. And we thank you just for the ability to be here today and to worship you. And I ask that as we move into worship time, dear God, you help us to focus our hearts and minds on who you are and just to give you the glory and honor that you deserve. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Well, I'm going to invite you to stand as you're able. And we're going to worship a little bit together.
Holy, holy,
you are
holy, holy.
You made me take away.
Father, we come this morning, Father, giving you praise, Father, for who you are. Father, for your love. Father, for your willingness to be merciful. And Father, for your amazing grace. Father, we also give you thanks for the land that we live in, Father. And Father, we give thanks for all those that have made it possible, especially your Son. And Father, we just beg for forgiveness for drifting away as a country, Father. So Father, we pray today for revival. And Father, now as we also pause to give thanks for this offering, Father, just thank you for each gift. Father, may you use it for the ongoing of your kingdom. Father, forgive us when we fail you, for we pray it all in your Son's holy name. Amen.
As I was sitting there on the front pew and we were singing that last song, Blessed Be the Name, I was struck with something that I wasn't prepared for. In the last couple of weeks, I've had a lot of you that have asked how Jennifer's doing, and I tell you the same thing, that we're hoping in the Lord and that we're, you know, putting one foot in front of the other, that she's healing and all that kind of stuff, and all of those things are true. But I realized in a moment this morning that in the last few weeks, because she's not progressed as quickly as she had hoped, or we had hoped, or doctors had hoped, a lot of that has to do with the fact that she's a transplant patient. She's on anti-rejection medication. That fights against her body to heal the way that it needs to. Her incision is not healing the way it needs to, and all of that stuff. Then the last couple of weeks, I have found myself being frustrated with why God is dragging his feet and getting her back up on her feet. And I'm sitting here and I'm singing, Blessed be the name of the Lord. And I felt the hypocrisy in my heart. I think that there are moments in our lives to where we feel stretched and we feel frustrated with God, and without even realizing it, we become impatient with Him and we think that our timetable, our way, our expectation is best. We think that the way that we would do things is better than the way that God would do things, and that we know something that He doesn't. And I'll be real honest with you, as I stand up here in front of you, I had to do a little bit of soul searching. I'm about to talk about God's Word. I'm about to have a conversation with you about some truths that are here, and God had to kind of whip me a little bit before I got up here. Now, do I not believe in a big God? Of course I do. Do I not trust in a big God? Of course I do. But in some measure, there are moments that life is just overwhelming. And when we get squeezed, some of the worst parts of who we are exposed. But you know what the amazing thing is? There is a big God in heaven that says, I get it, son. I know. But you just need to hold on to me. The original opening to my sermon was going to be talking about the two knotheads that the Lord has blessed me with. I have two incredible sons. They take after their mother. This morning, though, those two sweet, precious creations of the Lord that I have been blessed with did not understand that Dad had to be at church at a certain time. Now, I am very blessed that I had a mother that taught me how to cook and clean and do all that kind of stuff. And I'll be honest with you, one of my biggest pet peeves is to hear, and y'all can get on to me later, is to hear ladies say, men can't do anything. That's like, just drives me bananas. My mom raised me that I didn't need some woman. Some of y'all are like going, what? No, wait. Now, hang on, Rodney. Making cereal, that's not cooking. I learned how to cook. I learned how to clean. My roommates in college said, you will make somebody a good wife one day. Having no idea that there was going to be 16 years of marriage, and Jennifer and I have been through 13 major surgeries together. 13. I wish they had frequent flyer miles for that stuff. But you know what? There are moments that you're taking care of things. Now, I want to say this. I love being a part of First Baptist because I truly believe, even though there are things that we are still need to get better at, there's still things that we need to refine, there's still ways that we need to have a deeper passion for who God is, that we need to be about His business, that we need to keep from falling over ourselves so that we and not get being about His business. I will tell you this, that First Baptist understands what it is to be a family. I think I shared this with you a few weeks ago. God has blessed us in 10 years of being here. The way that y'all have brought meals to the house, the calls, the cards, the just little things that nobody will ever know about that you have done for us that have demonstrated the depths of the way that you love us in Christ. But I know that we're not the only family that can say that. There are family upon family upon family that can say that about our church, because I think that's something that we get. We understand that we're supposed to love each other. But even in those moments, life can still get overwhelming. And in those moments, the simplest of things can distract us and keep us from seeing a big God. And this morning, it was two knuckleheads that didn't understand what a 5-minute shower is. We were up a little bit too late last night because somebody was shooting too many fireworks. I don't know who that was. And so they got in the bed, and our deal was is that I'm going to let you sleep in just a little bit, but I need you to get ready. I need you. We've got to get to church. I have a meeting. We meet as a staff. Some other folks are involved with service. We meet before this service and pray. Make sure that we've got all of our ducks in a row. Well, as y'all can tell, Brother Tony is traveling with his family. And so I was the one responsible for making sure that to start that meeting. And I'm sitting here and time is ticking. And as some of you in the tenure that I've had here figured out real quick with me, patience is not one of those things that the Holy Spirit has developed quite yet in my life. Patience is not one of those things. So I wake them up, and of course I've got that justice stripe too, that if Dad says it, you're supposed to do it. No questions asked, no grace, no nothing. You better get your clothes on, teeth brushed, hair brushed, and get out the door, or you will be walking to 407 South First Street. We're going, and then of course, what happens? I tell them what time I need to leave, and they don't leave. And it's, come on, guys, I need you to do this. And it's frustrating because they have told me, I will do this, and then they don't do it. Now, there are other times that these sweet little precious boys will do things without being asked. They will drag their feet and stuff, and then they get it done. They will do things that just blow my mind. And I got to thinking about this, even this morning. This is the same way that God relates to us. He has called us. He is drawing us to Himself. And there's a lot of ways that we get hung up on things. We get confused by things. We get distracted. And we find ourselves not where we need to be. This morning, we're going to have a little conversation about a parable right after the triumphant entry. Matthew chapter 21 is where we're going to be headed to. I'm going to give you a little bit of backstory leading up to this parable that Jesus shares. It's the only place that it's recorded. It's recorded in the book of Matthew. In no other place is this parable, this little short parable, is recorded. But I think it's significant. I think it's significant for us. Today, we're celebrating Independence Day. Tomorrow's actually the 4th, but we tend to, you start seeing the red, the white, and the blue. You begin to see the flag. You begin to be reminded that a long time ago, 1776, was a group of men that said, enough's enough. We want our freedom. We want to be liberated from the oppression that is coming from across the ocean in England. Shortly after that, they ratified the Constitution. And now we have this rich history that is America. I never had the privilege of serving our country in the military, but my dad did, and my granddad did. I had other family members that did. They stood in harm's way, so I have the opportunity to stand here this morning and do this without fear. But many of us, as you watch the news, as you see the things that are going on in the world, in particular the things that are taking place within our country, your calm begins to get a little shaken, doesn't it? Back in May, we had a conversation that we don't have to. Our hope is not bound up in what government does. Our hope is not bound up in anything other than God and what He has called us to. And it talks about being preserved as a nation. He's going to preserve us as individuals. And something that we need to remember, that we need to be very, very careful about, is that as we read Scripture and we talk about being preserved as a nation, that we don't mistake America for Israel. We have to be very careful. God still has a purpose for Israel. He has a very clear purpose, and it's working itself out. But we cannot forget that we are not Israel. America is not God's chosen people. We are His chosen people because we have a relationship with His Son. But that's not a national thing. That is an individual thing. So we have to be very careful about when we think about the laws and we think about our country, that when we are not who we need to be as individuals, then we can't be who we need to be as a nation. But God deals with us individually. So we can't hide behind that we were once a Christian nation. We can't hide behind the fact that we're good, moral individuals. We can't hide behind the picture that God is going to deal with us because we're America. I have a book on my shelf written by John MacArthur, and it says, "Can God bless America?" And it begins to beg the question of, can He do something when our hearts are not where they need to be? And what he's talking to is he's talking to the American church. What he's talking to are the members of those American churches. What he's talking to are those of us who name the name of Christ and are also citizens of this great nation. He's dealing with us individually. Now here's the problem. If we're not careful, we start to have a bravado about ourselves. We start to get a little bit big for our britches, and we keep thinking, as unfortunately we had some folks thinking, that there are things that are too big to fail. None of us are too big to fail. This is why we are so dependent on God the Father. The minute that we think that we've got it figured out, the minute that I think, as I shared with you just a few minutes ago, the minute that I think that I've got it figured out better than God, God, you need to hurry up and do things my way, is the moment that I fall flat on my face. Why? Because it's now about Rodney and not about the God that gives me purpose. So here's the hard part. In all of that, this is not a new thing. This is something that people have wrestled with for a long time. And those people, again, just like us, that should know better, didn't know better. The religious leaders, the scribes, the Pharisees, the elders, these wise people didn't get it. So we step into this picture of the triumphant entry. Matthew chapter 21, verses 1 through 11, talks about Jesus coming in. They were laying cloaks down. They were waving palm branches. They were screaming, "Hosanna, Hosanna." How cool would it be to have been on that street that day as He rides in on this donkey? It's enough that in verse 11, there's this excitement that shakes the whole city. It shakes everyone that's there. You can tell there's something going on. Have you ever been at Walmart? You know there's always a good story that starts when you're at Walmart in Pulaski. Have you ever been at Walmart and you're a couple of aisles over and all of a sudden you know there's something going on because folks start moving around? What is our tendency? I want to go see what's going on. This is fun. I could use this for a sermon. Now, I mean, you start looking and you want to figure out what's going on. The other day, as the kids were coming back from kids camp, we're sitting and waiting, and all of a sudden, I don't know what was going on, but I think that there were two different situations that happened on Popular Street at the same time, and there was all kinds of things that were moving. That does not enhance the calm of moms that are waiting for their kids to get back from camp when all of a sudden there's ambulances and fire trucks and all this kind of stuff that are coming towards the church. That does not enhance the calm of some moms. But in those moments, what is going on? What's going on? This is the same thing. As Jesus is riding in, their focus is completely on Him. And if we know anything about the religious leaders at that time, where did they want the attention? On themselves. On their authority. On their teaching. On their status. That was it. If I am thought well of, if people are responding to me, that's what matters. But in this case, all the focus was on whom? Jesus Christ. Verses 12 and 13 of chapter 21, He goes to the temple. At that time, it was the week of Passover. A lot of folks were funneling into Jerusalem. They were going to be making sacrifice, many of them traveling a long way. And it was difficult for them to bring a lot of times their sacrifices with them. So the religious leaders and merchants at that time had figured out, hey, the easiest thing to do is to simply set up shop here in the temple compound. the temple complex, and will sell sacrifices. Now, they are entrepreneurs just like every ballpark that we've ever been to, and we've paid $8 for a hot dog. There is no way that that hot dog costs $8. Why? You're paying for convenience. You're paying for a guy saying hot dogs to walk down next to you and hand it to you. For it to have a little wrapper that says Titans or Sounds or whatever sport team that you're going to see. You're paying for that. There's no way that it costs that. And this is the same thing that was taking place in the temple complex. People were being cheated. What was supposed to be a reminder of God's mercy, blood being shed to cover the sins of the people, was turned into an entrepreneurial opportunity to make money. They cheapened the sacrifice to a dollar bill. This is what's going on. Jesus comes in, they're lauding him. So what does he do? He goes in and he very politely and meekly says, "Gentlemen, would you please stop doing this?" Now what does he do? He goes in, he turns the tables over. It turns his stomach. You're missing it. So he turns the tables over. You step into verses 14 through 17, and he begins to heal there in the temple complex. Now, again, imagine there's just a slew of people that are all over the place. And all of a sudden, he starts putting his hands on blind people and they can see. He begins to speak to those that are lame and they can get up and walk. Children start to praise him. And of course, the Pharisees and Sadducees, the religious leaders, get ticked off. Do you hear, and they even say to Jesus, do you hear what they're saying? Do you hear what they're saying? Praise be the Son of David. Praise be to Him. And then he just quotes, I love Jesus. I want to be more like Him. I have the tendency that I want to go on the defense. I want to fight somebody. When we get crossways, I want them to say that I'm right. I have a tendency to lean that way. Don't know why, it's just the way that I'm wired. But that's not how Jesus was. Because he was very secure in who he was. Very secure in who he is. Very secure in the way that he was speaking in authority. And so when these guys came up and said, do you not see this? I don't care what you say, guys. I know I'm God wrapped in flesh. But they didn't get that, did they? He was just another religious leader. He was this upstart from Nazareth. So they come in and he says, do you not know that it says that the little children out of the mouths of babes will truth come? Don't you imagine these guys got sick and tired of talking to Jesus? Because every time they did, they had to leave with their tails tucked between their legs. Because he had a confidence and an authority that came from the only place that any of us have authority. And that's through his Father. Then we have him going and verses 18 through 22, he goes and he spends the night in Bethany, which again, that's a very common practice that we see all through Scripture that Jesus did. So he slips over to Bethany, gets up the next morning, he comes by and he sees the fig tree, and he walks to the fig tree, and of course it's early in the morning, he's hungry, he reaches to get, there's nothing on the fig tree. It's a time of year when the fig tree should be in bloom, it should have fruit on it, but it doesn't. So Jesus curses it and it withers. Now, this is one of those little bit scary verses. Brother Tony's been doing this awesome series on scary verses. This is a little bit scary. You think about that Jesus, because it doesn't bear fruit, it's done. That almost seems a little bit, I don't know, mean of Jesus. Well, we don't know what's going on. Maybe a worm had cut into that. We don't know what's going on. But the problem was, is it was really not about the fig tree. It wasn't about the fact that Jesus was hungry. It wasn't really about any of that. It was a teachable moment for his disciples. If we don't bear fruit, we wither. If we don't bear fruit, we're not useful. If we don't bear fruit, it begs the question whether we are really, truly a fig tree or whether we are really, truly who we need to be. It goes back to the John 15 conversation. Anyone who is in me will bear much fruit. Apart from me, you can do nothing. This is where we begin to wrestle and where we have to take a hard look at ourselves and the disciples. If you're not bearing fruit, if there's not things in your life, you have to imagine one of the guys sitting here is Judas. He's hearing this. And we know that Judas never really embraced who Jesus was. He was a part of his 12. He heard all the teachings, but we figure out real quickly that for him, it was about a political thing, or it was about a personal thing. It was about something other than the transformative work of the one that he was walking around with. Judas heard this. They get the temple complex and they come in, and immediately the question is posed, by what authority do you do these things? They come to Jesus. This is where, again, I love Jesus. Because he makes this, he very rarely answers questions straight. How does he answer them? With a question. Well, let me answer your question with a question. Why is he doing that? Because in that moment, he knows it has nothing to do whatsoever with being right or wrong. This is all about saving face. This is all about authority in the religious leader's standpoint. Who is it that gets to say? So Jesus asked the question. He says, by what authority did John do these things? Where was his baptism from? I love it. So I just imagine Jesus says this and they all huddle up. This is not in Scripture. This is in Rodney's head. They all gather up. They're all talking. And it's kind of like a, well, if we say that it's from heaven, then he's gonna say, well, why didn't you believe him? So we can't say that. Well, if you say from men, all these people, they're going to jump us because they believe that he was a prophet and most of them got baptized by him. So there's no good way to get out of this without saving face. It wasn't about what truth was at all, was it? Had nothing to do about what the truth was. It was a political positioning so that they looked good. And so what do they answer? Like a good politician does. I don't know. I have no recollection, Senator. I don't know. I must have deleted that email. I don't really know. That was uncalled for. I shouldn't have said that. So I don't remember. I don't know. I don't know what's going on. I'm going to be in trouble. I don't know. And then I love what Jesus says. I'm not going to tell you where my authority that comes from then. Don't you know how frustrating that had to be for them? Because they're not getting anywhere. But immediately he shares this parable. And this is where we want to talk today. The parable says this, beginning in verse 28, Matthew 21. But what do you think? A man has two sons. He went to the first and he said, my son, go, work in the vineyard today. Now that's the first thing he says. He goes to his son. He has two sons. He goes to one of the sons and he says, go work in the vineyard. Now, the idea that's here, and it's not fleshed out in Scripture, but understanding how this worked, more than likely the vineyard was not right there. The vineyard was going to be way out away. It was going to be out in the country. It was going to be out further. It was not going to be there where they probably lived in town, so to speak. So there was a commitment that he was asking of this son. I want you to get up from what you're doing. I want you to stop what you're doing. I want you to remove yourself from the comfort of our home. And I'm going to ask you, if you would, to go and work in the field. I'm going to ask you to get up and to go. Well, this son looks at him and says what? No. No, I'm not going. My son, go and work in the field today. Verse 29, he says this. He answered, I don't want to. Yet later he changed his mind and went. Then he went to the other and asked the same thing. This first son, I'm not going. But then later he changes his mind and he goes. By the way, I'm not sure what your translation says. If any of you have the King James, it says the word what? He repented. He repented. He changed his mind. He heard the truth of what his father was asking him to do, and he changed his mind, and he went to the field to work. Now he goes and he asks his other son the same question. And this is what he says. I will, sir, he answered, but he never went. I will, sir, but he never went. So the first son, no, I'm not going to go. He repents and he goes. The second son, oh yes, Father, I will go. Yet he never goes. Now Jesus is about to ask a question that the Pharisees aren't prepared for. He's about to ask them. He's about to put them on display for themselves. He's about to pull the rug out from under him because he's about to ask what question? Who was faithful? They immediately answer, whom? The first son. And that's when he says, that is why tax collectors and prostitutes will enter the kingdom of God before you do. Think about what he just told them. This is why the people that you think are not holy enough to walk into this temple complex where we're having this conversation. This is why those that you would consider to be outcasts, because tax collectors worked for the government. They were known to be cheats. They were known to be people that they were opportunistic, trying to make money. The people that were doing this, this is who they were known to be. And then prostitutes, they were not faithful to a single person. They were, again, opportunistic, and they were working to just simply get whatever they can to this. They were to basically sell themselves. All of these people were considered to not be worthy of any type of grace from God. And Jesus says that these people will enter before you do. Why? Why would he say to them that they would? Well, he spells it out here. He says, when John came to you in the way of righteousness, you didn't believe him. But tax collectors and prostitutes did believe him. But you, when you saw it, didn't even change your mind or believe him. There's something sobering for us this morning. Very sobering related to this. Because we can, all of us in this, identify with one of those brothers. Now some of us are thinking, well, I was never a tax collector or a prostitute, Rodney. That's not what I'm saying. All of us at some point have wrestled with responding or rejecting. For some of us, it took a long time to get there before the light bulb went on. We grew up around church, or we grew up around, you know, good folks. We were good moral people. Maybe we made choices that were out there. Some of us sitting in this room have got stories that would break our hearts, because we spent a whole lot of life running from God. But in the end, the grace of God opened up the door and embraced it. And we know what Scripture says, those who have been forgiven much, forgive much. If when your life has been radically changed, whether it seems from the world's perspective to be radically changed, when you truly have an encounter with God, it does something to you, amen? It changes the way you think. It changes the way that you relate to people. It changes everything about you. It draws you to something different. But the scary part is, there are a lot of folks that would say, my name is on a roll, that raise their hand at some point and says, yes, God, I will go, but have never truly surrendered to who Jesus Christ is. These men that were standing here as they were talking, they were depending on their ability. They were depending on their status. They were depending on the fact that they were good Jewish men. They had kept the law. They were seeking to make sure others kept the law. This was coming at times probably from a very altruistic place, a very deep place of devotion to God. But when they were exposed to the truth, they didn't want to hear the truth because it changed the way that they had to think. It changed their expectations. It moved from being something that I control to something that you relinquish all control to the one that created us. We have two sons. When John shows up as the precursor to Jesus, as the forerunner, and he begins to preach and he begins to baptize, who is it that gravitates towards him? It's not the intelligent folks. It's not the folks that were in power at the time. Who is it? Those of us that understand our brokenness. Those of us that understand that we have no right to claim righteousness apart from Jesus Christ. That there's none of us that can go, yes, I was so good that God just had to let me in. What do we bring to the table with Jesus? Nothing but broken lives. And this is why that we find in 1 Samuel, we find in Hebrews chapter 10, we find in Micah chapter 6, God does not desire sacrifice. His desire is obedience. That is what it is that draws His heart. Obedience on our part. Going back to the boys for just a second. I don't need them to look at me and say, okay, Daddy, you're in charge. We get it. We'll do what you ask me to do. Sure, whatever, Dad. Well, we'll do it. You're Dad. We have to, as long as I live at your house, I guess I'll have to do what you ask me to do. But as soon as I'm out on my own, I'll do my own thing. The moments as a dad that I get excited about are those moments to where you know that they're doing what's asked of them because they love you. Folks, why do we struggle? Why is it that we are like the Pharisees so often? Yes, God, I'll do it. But for some reason, we never get around to doing it. This passage is talking specifically about salvation. But I think we can understand it too in that we have a very specific call on our lives that when the Lord calls, we respond. By the way, sometimes we think about this. The nominating committee is meeting right now. Committee on committees is meeting right now. This is not what I'm talking about. I'm not telling you that you need to make sure that you're serving somewhere in the church. What I'm telling you is that if we don't do something outside this building, if we are not faithful outside this building, it won't make any difference what we do in this building, because this building is not what's going to change the world. It's going to be us being the hands and feet of Jesus Christ within our community, within our families. That is where it's going to matter. This is what we're called to. Not to be more active in church, but to be a more active body within our community. When we do that, we glorify God. We want to make this harder than it has to be. I would love to have, when we finish the sermon today, for people to come and tackle me. Would you please give me an opportunity to teach? Would you please give me an opportunity to serve? I would love for that to happen. But you know what would be more of a blessing to the Lord? Would be not for more people to get involved here, though that is a good thing. Would be for people to walk out today and to go sit down with a neighbor and say, hey, look, I want you to know that there's a great God that loves you. I want you to know that there's a truth. For that, those words to be echoed by our lives. This is where we get back to those statements to where God is broken over His people because He makes this statement. Their lips profess me, but their hearts are far from me. We live in a time to where people are creating ways to do evil. You start watching the news and your heart starts to hurt. But the amazing thing is, God loves us in spite of that. And if we're not careful, the flip side of what we'll do too is not only will we miss it, but we will put up so many roadblocks for people to come to Christ that they miss the depths of His love. And when they show up with their broken lives, they're falling over us to try to get to Him. We need to be reminded that when we came to the table, all we had was a broken life. And the God of all creation loved us enough to send His one and only Son. And because of that, that draws us to something that is so precious. And that is the love, patience, grace, and mercy. I am so thankful that you don't know my heart and my life all the time. Because there's times that I'm ashamed of who I am. Because I am not who God called me and created me to be. But when it's all said and done, it won't make a bit of difference what you say about who I am. It will only matter what He says about who I am. This morning, that should liberate every person sitting in here. Every person that has heard these words this morning. It doesn't make any difference who we have been. It only depends on who He is in our lives. Now you take that out into the world, or right now we are valuing people based on whether they are helpful or they agree with us or we think the same kind of thoughts or any of that kind of stuff. That's how people have value. We have value because we are His creation. And we are broken because of our selfishness. And this is why tax collectors and prostitutes will get there first, because they understand. They see. When you're hurting, you need hope. And that's who Jesus is. So this morning, this is my question to you. 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verses 18 through 25, and I won't read it. What it says is that God's wisdom confounds the wisdom of this age. The wisdom of this age says what the Pharisees say. Sure, I'll tip my hat to some kind of spirituality, but I'm not going to involve myself in it. The first son is who we need to be. Whether it's a short delay, long delay, whatever it's been, we need to be about what God has called us to do. This morning, if you don't have a relationship with God through His Son, Jesus Christ, you know what He says to you? My child, I love you. I've demonstrated that in my Son. This morning, you could be white as snow. And now you have the opportunity to live for me. For those of us that have gotten comfortable, those of us that have stopped challenging ourselves, for those of us that are allowing ourselves to go through the motions, maybe this morning we have been sitting here going, yes, God, I will go, and yet, yes, God, I will make a change. Yes, God, I will do differently. I'm going to change the way that I live. I'm going to seek to be a holy husband, a holy dad. I'm going to be a better employee. I'm going to work to be a better wife. I'm going to work to be a better daughter, or to be a better son. I'm going to work to do these things, God. Yes, I'm going to do that. And then what happens is we're just like the second brother. We walk out of here and nothing changes. But this morning, through the power of God, we can be transformed. We can do things differently. When we leave here today, we can have the opportunity to go and share that with other people, that hope. Again, we make it more complicated than it has to be. It's not that hard. It's one beggar tell another beggar where the bread is. We don't have a special knowledge. It's revealed in His Word. It's revealed in His person. And it can be revealed through our lives so that others will know. Tomorrow, a lot of folks across our country are going to pile up together, eat hamburgers, hot dogs, shoot fireworks, talk about politics. We have an opportunity in those conversations to talk about the hope of Jesus Christ. We have the opportunity every single day for our lives to flavor the community around us. We can't fix the world. God's already given us an opportunity to do that through His Son. We don't do it. We can't worry about the whole world. What we got to worry about is what He's called us to. Wherever it is that we are, here, there, and everywhere, to have that opportunity. So this morning, where do you find yourself as brothers? Where's your heart? How do we respond? We're going to sing Living for Jesus this morning. A life that is true. Are we living that life that is true? Something that I say a lot, I don't know why I do, other than the fact that it's something that I feel strongly. We as Baptists, I think we worry about this carpet. I think we worry about coming down here, and I think a lot of it has to do with that we're so worried what everybody else in this room is thinking when we're down here. I'll tell you this. If somebody in this room is worried about what's down here, let them worry. Because ultimately, when we stand before God, none of our opinions are going to matter. The only opinion that's going to matter is the one that breathed life into us and gave us purpose. And this morning, if you need to do some business with Him, I challenge you to come down. By the way, there's nothing special about the carpet, so you don't have to come down here, but sometimes we need to. But before we leave today, let us respond to His Word, to His call, to His purpose, so that we are useful to Him in all aspects of our lives. Let's pray, and then we're going to sing. Father God, this morning, remind us of how much you love us. Remind us of how patient you are with us. Remind us that you see into our situation and that your desire is for us to be in a relationship with you. Don't let us miss that because we think that we have done the right kinds of things. Don't let us miss that because we are enamored with other stuff that's going on. Help us to see what you have called us to, and that is purely to be obedient. For us to take hold of you so that we can live our lives in a way that glorifies you, that speaks to your power, that speaks to your grace and to your mercy, that speaks to the depths of your love. If there's one here this morning, Father, that is struggling, I pray that this morning they would find comfort and hope and strength in you. Father, let us sing in spirit and in truth. We love you. We ask all this in Jesus' name. Let's stand and sing.
Father God, as we go out into the world, Father, we just pray that we're the first son, God. We're the one that chooses, even in our hardships, God, to take that call and to show other people who you are, God. We just love you, and it's in your son's holy name we pray. Amen.